The story of Hannah and her struggles to get pregnant is valuable to us now because it is not a one-off. It is not a story that happened when that happened then and does not happen now. It happens again and again, even in the Hebrew Bible. These pairings of wives where one can conceive and another cannot. You might remember Leah and Rachel in Genesis 29 as the sisters who are both wives to Jacob. Leah seems to get pregnant every time she uses Jacob's toothbrush, whereas Rachel, Jacob's favorite, cannot get pregnant even after Leah has had five sons. She finally has Joseph, the most beloved. Before that, the founding father of the nation, Abraham, could not reproduce with Sarah, his wife, and they lost faith in God's promise. Sarah took matters into her own hands and told Abraham to impregnate the slave Hagar, Genesis 16 and 21. Hagar has Ishmael, whom the Arab nations claim as their ancestor, connected to Abraham as his firstborn. And then Sarah has Isaac and wants Hagar out of there because Ishmael is the firstborn and Sarah does not want him pulling rank on her own kid. These are harsh, painful stories about faith and faithlessness, devotion, suffering, heartache, and regret, and luck. If a woman has no children and her husband dies, she is in a precarious position. This is why Naomi, Ruth's mother-in-law, wanted to change her name to Bitterness, because she had a full life and then it emptied out. As she saw it, God turned his hand against her and robbed her of her husband, and then one son, and then another. Now, we have to be careful not to project our own values onto these people who lived 2,500 years ago. These people would be lucky to live to be 40. If they were rich, or at least prosperous, they could make it to 70 or more, 70. But that depended on good fortune, hard work, and the blessing of children to help out and to be strong as the parents became weak. The man's job was to raise and kill animals, protect the flock and family from bandits and other dangers. And the woman's job was to manage the household, make the meals, and provide offspring at a regular clip. To make the matters worse, we have the other wife, Peninnah, who mocks Hannah. Elkanah loves Hannah more, and in fact is generous to her, giving her a double portion, even though the Lord has closed her womb. Peninnah would provoke Hannah severely, to irritate her, to make her life a living hell, to get back at the favorite. Hannah stops eating, begins to wither away. She brings herself to God and throws herself at his mercy. Elkanah doesn't get it. Why do you weep? Am I not worth more to you than 10 sons? That is the voice of the clueless husband. He thinks he is so important and valuable that he should be satisfied with his, that she should be satisfied with his approval, his love, his generosity to her, and quit wanting what she can't have. In other words, he just doesn't get it. It is at this point that I slip in joke number 4. Question: what is the difference between childbirth and a husband? Answer: one can be terribly painful and sometimes almost unbearable, while the other is just about having a baby. Elkanah is no help. So Hannah turns to God. Now, our faith is a tradition based on storytelling. So let's go over this piece a bit. Verse 10, Hannah was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She made this vow: O Lord of hosts, if only you will look upon the misery of your servant. If only you will look upon the misery of your servant. People expected God to know what was happening and to act upon it. and remember me, and not forget your servant, but will give your servant a male child. Then I will set him before you as a Nazarite until the day of his death. He shall drink neither wine nor intoxicants, and no razor shall touch his head. A Nazarite is a priest, like an order of monks who pledge abstinence to maintain their spiritual purity. And they work at the temple to assist the head priests. So she is saying, I do not even want him for myself. I will give him to you. Just allow me to know this experience that other women know, to fulfill the destiny of women, so that I will not be denied this ultimate act of service. And so I will not be painfully mocked and derided anymore. Look upon me. Remember me. Do not forget me. See me in my dire agony. She is pledging the son to God because she is the servant of God and wants to do what a servant does. Bring something to God that God will find useful in his work. And then she will be praised. Well done, good and faithful servant. Anyone who has gone through this fertility struggle knows that this misery goes beyond merely not getting what you want. It is a desolation. It is a shattering of hope and dreams. It is crying on every Mother's Day. It is crying on every Father's Day. It is crying at your own birthdays. It is crying at every Christmas. It is not being able to be around families that have kids, and you become more and more isolated. You try and distract yourself with other things, indulgences, good food, foreign travel, lots of movies. But there's nothing that even begins to touch the void deep in your very soul. Hannah prays in agony, silently, but with the charming practice of moving her lips as she speaks. Eli sees her praying and assumes she is hammered, which is in line with Eli's failure in other areas of his life to perceive what people are about. He is a famously lousy father. And maybe we can see here why that is. He is an insensitive dolt. He tries to kick her out of the temple because he thinks she is making a spectacle of herself. But Hannah, who knows of doltish men, does not care what he thinks and rebuts him. No, my Lord, I am a woman deeply troubled. I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Not you, Eli. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman, as everyone else does, because I am childless. For I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation at this time. Hannah is not going anywhere until she has made her case to God. Eli snaps around. He seems to understand the devotion of this woman is showing in her prayers. He senses her prayers are being answered and does a righteous priestly thing. Go in peace. The God of Israel will grant the petition that you have made him. Hannah takes this to heart. She goes home. She has some wine with her husband. She is without the sadness clouding her features anymore, and she retires for the evening. She has somehow accepted that her deepest prayer has been answered. The Lord remembered her. In due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son. She named him Samuel, for she said, I have ask him of the Lord. You may recall that El in Samuel is a Canaanite word for God, which the Hebrew people adopted. And we hear its echo in Emmanuel, or God is with us, or El Shaddai, God Almighty, or Elohim, the Mighty One. So Samuel means I have asked God for him, or God has heard me asking for him. This is a reversal of fortune for him. Everything changes now. She has fulfilled her womanly destiny as she perceives it. She has given the ultimate offering to God, one that money can't buy. She has silenced that mouthy Penina, and she has felt that God has answered a prayer. She can now relax, knowing that it happened in God's time. Like Ruth and Naomi, everything went from bleak to bright in a flash. This is the happy ending. This is the story of the guy, Samuel, that anoints David as the king of Israel. David is the first Messiah, the first anointed one. So we need a story to give legitimacy to the one conferring God's authority onto this human. This is a parallel plot structure to the birth of Jesus, a miracle birth promised by God, the praise of a woman whose prayer is answered, a child consecrated as a dedicated servant by a spirit-driven and devoted mother servant. What follows is Hannah's prayer of praise for God, and it is about reversals. As Jesus says, the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Here is its Jewish roots. Chapter 2, verse 3. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble gird on strength. The barren has borne 7, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low. He also exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of the faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness. For not by might does one prevail. Instead, she prevailed through faith and devotion. It wasn't by strength or power or money that motivated God to intercede with Hannah. It was Hannah willing to wait for God's own time. Things came to fruition. Don't shake the tree, says God. Wait for the fruit to fall. These assertions give us plenty of food for thought. We can see through this tale that things don't show up just because we want them to. It also shows that when someone is waiting for something that is not happening, if someone is waiting for a miracle, we need to accompany them, to walk beside them. We don't need to try and fix them or tell them to get over it or point out that everything else is pretty good. So why are you so hung up on this one thing you can't have? It is a hard thing when someone is suffering, is in pain, has a chronic illness, is under duress, or threatened with something they cannot control. Our best offering is our own sympathy, showing them that we know their pain, we feel the hurt, and then we offer them our silence. We offer them our very selves. In that silence, we can murmur a prayer that God keeps this person company, that this suffering will pass sooner rather than later. Then make some coffee, pour some tea, bring out the scones. We cannot know the future, except we all gotta go. Till then, we keep each other company. We do what we can, and we do what is within our power to ease the pain of others on the way. Her story from Mark is a coda to this tale of reversals, of not knowing what is to come. There is some historical background information that is not found in the text because at the time everyone knew. The history was recent. Jesus grew up in Nazareth in Galilee. About 7 miles away is a town called Sepphoris, the Roman name for Zippori, a Greek trading town that was established in the time of Alexander. It had a city center in the model that Alexander established throughout his conquests, a marketplace or agora, a library, a city hall, an amphitheater, and probably a racetrack. After Herod's death in 4 BCE, a rebel named Judas attacked Sepphoris, then the administrative center of the Galilee, and sacking its treasury and weapons, armed his followers in a revolt against Herodian rule. The Roman governor in Syria, Varus, was reported by Josephus to have then burnt the city down and sold its rebellious inhabitants into slavery. So Jesus knew what the Romans did to rebellious cities. Jesus did not commit a miracle when he said this about the temple, which has been seen by some as a prophecy, as like fortune telling. He was just using his head, his own experience, and what he knew about the Jewish population around Jerusalem. It was like a tinderbox, ready to blow at any time. And the assumption, when you look at a beautiful building made out of stone with giant blocks of sandstone that weigh 50 tons, blocks too heavy for us to even lift now, we assume it is going to be there forever. And Jesus was right. Revolution and rebellion in this time period occurred with devastating frequency. The Jewish people were too rebellious to put up with the Greeks, the Romans, and even the Herodians. But they were not strong enough to keep them out. They were living on prime real estate, where the trade from Egypt went up the Fertile Crescent into Mesopotamia. Location, location, location. Verse 1, as Jesus came out of the temple, one of the disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." The disciples are men of their times, and they are looking for ways to foretell the future. They are part of a culture that wants to know about the end times, when God will come and set things right to do justice for Israel and kick out these wicked Romans. They seem to interpret this statement as one where Jesus is telling them to get ready. Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come." That means not now. "For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs." In other words, not now. I interpret this to mean that they want a sign, but they will not get a sign. "You will get many men who will try and tell you they are from me, and they know what will happen, and they can see the future. They have no idea. You may hear of wars. You will certainly hear rumors of wars as people try and know if this is a sign that the end time is upon us. Wars will eventually come again and again, as will earthquakes, because that is how our planet operates. Earthquakes and wars come and go. They are not the sign of the day of judgment." In other words, you cannot know what God intends. You cannot know when something will happen when prayers are answered, when babies will show up, when kings will conquer, when nations will rise and fall. It is not for us to know. What is for us to know is who we are and what we do with our time. No one is promised even one more day than today. And we should live as though this may be the last day that we are remembered for. The things we pray for, they could happen. The things we work for, we may accomplish them. The work we put in, it may yet pay off. But there's no certainty to any of it. We live by faith and faith alone. We must have the patience and devotion to never give up. And we must be open to the wisdom, the strength, and the miracles that God can deliver in God's own time. And then we will face astonishment.